Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we will discuss a module on Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. This module is prepared by Sanchoita Chakraborty, Bankura University. The objectives of this module are, this module intends to give a comprehensive idea about the Australian poetry by the writers of the European descent. It will introduce the major Australian poets of European descent. It will offer a critical overview of the major poems by the Australian poets of the European descent. The module will further analyze how these Australian poets of European descent engage with the Australian themes like bush poetry, outback, mateship, and the Australian nature tinged with beauty and terror. Now, let us begin. Australia emerged as a country which contained a number of colonies at the early phase of Western domination. The first generation of Australian writers came from these places, where people from various European countries arrived and settled for generations. The first flowering of Australian literature unfolded through the works of these Australian writers of European descent. As the European influence is prominent in the first literary works, the early Australian literature often shared the English literary traditions. Poetry occupies a significant portion of the early Australian literature. Gradually, Australian literature has grown to be more Australian in tune and in theme. The writers of European descent have imbibed the Australian culture in their works, and Australian emerges anew through their works. Australian poetry by the writers of European descent followed the same trend. Early Australian poetry by writers of European descent. The early Australian writers of European descent share their awareness of belonging to a settler community. Their writing represents a celebration of pioneering Australian values and a deep attachment to the land, its nature and people. The early Australian poets of European descent, like Charles Thomson and William Wentworth, tried to capture their experience in the new and their sense of local pride as they were born in the colony in their work Australasia, 1823. The first volume of Australian poetry by the writers of European descent is barren. Is Barren Fields, First Fruit of Australian Poetry, 1819, which was published in Australia. The writers in the colony often expressed their nostalgia for home, their ancestral roots in European countries. A sense of exile haunted the poems of the convict songs and the bush ballads of that time. In this early phase of Australian poetry by the writers of European descent, Charles Harper's poetry presents the feel of 19th century British Romanticism. His poems paint the Australian landscape in the same tune which we find in William Wordsworth's landscape poetry. Percy Shelley's idealism and American transcendentalist Ralph Waldo Emerson's ideas were also quite influential on Harper's romantic poems. Nationalistic feelings where in the rise of the Australian poetry of the late 19th and the early 20th century, and the pioneering Australian journals like Bulletin promoted Australian literature for the Australian people. Australian poets of European descent also began to write Australian, and Henry Lawson emerged as the poet of the people. Another important contribution in the Bulletin was A.V. Banjo Peterson, who was hailed for his bush ballads. These two classical Australian poets, Lawson and Banjo Peterson, were entangled in the well-known Bulletin debate. This debate presented these two poets' perspectives on the Australian nature of life. Lawson wrote about the hard, realistic life of the bush, while the romantic bush life comes alive in the Peterson's poetry. Other important Australian poets of European descent are Henry Kendall, Christopher Brennan, and Adam Lindsay Gordon. Henry Kendall's Leaves from Australian Forest, 1869, brings his poetry of forest and mountain streams. His poetry focuses more on the sounds and descriptions than on actions. Christopher Brennan's poetry is characterized by the traditional style of poetry. Containing many classical allusions, he concentrated more on his symbolist poetry other than local preoccupations with nationalism. His poems in the volume Poems 1913, which was published in 1913, delved deep into the sources of spiritual restlessness through the use of myth and archetype. Adam Lindsay Gordon's poetry presents the traditional representation of Australian life. The poem The Six Stock Rider from his Bush Ballads and Galloping Rhymes conveys a sense of comradeship and detailing of Bushman's world. Another popular poet of this time, C.J. Dennis, reoriented many of the bush attitudes to the inner city through his verse on the sentimental block. Let us talk about modern Australian poetry. Modern Australian poetry begins not in the superficial depiction of Australian land and nature, but through a philosophical engagement with the spirit of Australia as rendered in the Australian stories. The poet Dorothy Potter seeks to tell the stories in a way so that they sear into the soul and can never be untold. This Australian spirit celebrates its unaffectedness by any European schools and traditions and presents its ingenuity. This willing seculation enables a poetic vantage point. The nature of modern Australian poetry is varied and quite debated by the writers of European descent. Sometimes it is cosmopolitan in nature. Sometimes it is the nationalist hues are dominant in these poems. Often it is iconic in expression. Amidst its wide variety in tunes and expressions, some thematic strains can well be discerned. A deep engagement with the Australian landscape and how the poets imagine it is something central to the modern Australian poetry. A kind of experimental writing is gaining the center stage. During the early decades of the 20th century, two poetic movements arose. These movements intended to define the modern Australian poetry, but from two different perspectives. These two movements, the Zindi Orobaks and the Angry Penguins, began in Adelaide. These two movements played a significant role in shaping the modern Australian poetry. Besides, essentially Australian qualities, other national, social, and urban issues are delineated in the contemporary Australian poetry in both realist and surrealist manners. Modern Australian poetry, by the writers of European descent, took many forms like sonnets, free verse, prose poems, and the unique verse novels. Australian performance poetry and the Australian poetry slam are other popular poetic schools. Now, let us talk about the Zindi Orobak movement. The Zindi Orobak movement began in the 1930s. It was a movement of poets who propagated a unique Australian poetry which would depict the distinctive Australian natural landscape, such as the desert and the bush in Australian terms. These poems would also incorporate the Aboriginal cultural elements and the Aboriginal perception of the Australian nature. Rex Ingamells was the pioneering figure of the poetry movement of the Australian poets of European descent. Conditional Culture, 1938, was the manifesto of this movement, in which Ingamells talked about the specific aims of the movement: a clear recognition of Australian values, the debunking of much nonsense, and an understanding of Australia's history and traditions, primeval, colonial, and modern. For the Zindi Orobak, the European culture is a conditional culture. They nurtured the literary nationalism further in Australian poetry. Unabated Spring, 1942, the book of poetry by Ian Moody, one of the founding members of Zindi Orobak movement, imbibed aboriginal errante words like Alkeringa, spirit of the place, in the poems. Rex Ingamells also wrote two volumes of poetry, Gumtops, 1935, and Forgotten People, 1936, as an outcome of the movement. Another important Zindi Orobak poet was Roland Robinson. Beyond the Grass Tree Spears, verse 1944, Language of the Sand, poems 1949, Legend and Dreaming, 1952, and Blackfeller, Whitefeller, 1958, are the major books of verse by Robinson. The last two books contained components from Aboriginal culture and dream stories. Now, let us talk about Angry Penguins and the literary modernism in Australian poetry. Another important poetry movement began in Adelaide in 1930s, centering on the publication of the literary journal Angry Penguins, founded by a group of Adelaide poets like Max Harris, Geoffrey Darton, Sam Kerr, and Paul Pefevre. This poetry movement promoted the possibility of experimentation, use of impression and surrealism and abstraction in writing poetry. For the leading poets of this journal, the Zindi Orobak movement is limited in its scope. The Arn Mallory works. Max Harris and the other poets like Reed and Nolan of Angry Penguins promoted the poetry of Arn Malley, a fictional poet, as modernist poet. The publication of the poetry of Arn Malley and Harris' propagation for this poetry was known as the Great Arn Malley Hoax in the history of Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. As Harris failed to realize the fictional entity of Arn Malley, but the legacy of Arn Malley relives through various paintings and fictional text. Sidney Nolan and Gary Shedd chose Arn Malley as a theme for their paintings. Peter Carey's novel, My Life as a Fake, is based on the theme of the artist as hoax and derives from the Arne Malley hoax. Now let us talk about mediative verse and other developments of modern Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. Besides the descriptive verse, the Australian poets of European descent moved to meditative lyrics. A new symbolic understanding of Australia emerges in the modern Australian poetry. Besides the poetic giants like Etty Hope, the Judith Wright, Douglas Stewart, James Macaulay, David Campbell, Rosemary Dobson, and Vivian Smith enriched this tradition of meditative verse. Etty Hope's poetic fabric is textured with the satiric, witty, and allusive tunes. His poetry often shows the influence of the middle style of John Dryden, the English neoclassical poet. We find a more emotionally charged poetic verse in Judith Wright's poetic waiver. Douglas Stewart's collected poems 1936 to 1967, which was published in 1967, brings in a mediative understanding of natural world in which Stewart conceives a deeper cosmic morality. James Macaulay's fine verses like Pieta and poems of Music Late at Night 1976 present a different facet of the contemporary Australian poetry. Les Moore's poetry in the late 20th century brings in his allusive voice. His poetry concentrated on the secular world of spiritual realities in his volume of poetry like Dog Foxfield 1990. He is concerned to find the importance of poetry in ordinary life. Bruce Dawes' Sometimes Gladness, 1993, represents Dawes' journalistic contemporary poetry. Robert Gray, in his verse volume like Piano, 1988, and Certain Things in 1993, wrote spare lyric poetry. Robert Adamson's The Clean Dark, 1989, and John Tranter's The Floor of Heaven, which was published in 1992, presents modern experimental poetry. The later part of the module will concentrate on the detailed discussion of the major Australian poets of the European descent in the later half of the 20th century. And the poets like Etty Hope is one among them. Etty Hope, as an Australian poet of the European descent, was quite conscious about the effect of the ancestral English poetry tradition and a simultaneous claim of writing Australian on the Australian writers of the European descent. Actually, the Australian literature was primarily written in the language of the settlers in English, but the thematic structure is rooted in the soil of Australia. Besides the modern urban landscape of advanced technological progress derived from the Western society, the Australian life of the bush and the desert, the ragged geographical reality of the vast continent reside side by side. This paradoxical understanding of Australian life and nature characterizes the poetry of Etty Hope. He is observant and individualistic in his response to the basic human experience, allusive and often erotic. His wit is poignant in his poetic expressions. His poetry turns to the conservative side. He is not a man of vernacular Australian. His poetic structures consist of both dialogic and ironic perspectives. His worldview presents a dialogue between the classical European poetics and the Australian spirit. His understanding of Australia is paradoxical, as presented in his famous poem, Australia. he wrote, "A nation of trees, drab green and desolate grey, in the field uniform of modern verse, darkens her hills, those endless outstretched paws of sphinx, demolished or stone lion worn away." Australia opens with this tone of ironic understatement. The Australian nature is painted with drab green and desolate grey, and the first few stanzas of the poem portray the geographical as well as the intellectual and emotional landscape of contemporary Australia. An elitesque urban Australia comes up in the following lines of the poem, where a sense of cultural deprivation is predominant. At the end of the poem, the poet anticipates the coming of the prophet out of lush jungle of modern thought to cure the cultured apes of their intellectual barrenness. Hope, another brilliant satiric creation, is Standardization, which mocks at the superficiality of the man-made creations and celebrates the power of nature, which produces volumes of shapes and sustenance. I see, stooping among her orchard tree, the old sound earth gathering her windfalls in, broad in the hums and stiffening in the knees, pause, and I see her grave, malicious green, for there is no manufacturer competes with her in the mass production of shapes and things. Over and over she gathers and repeats the cast of a face, a million butterfly wings. Hope thinks that nature, as the mother figure, standardized his ultimate needs and pains. Therefore, the man's understanding of standardization is fatuous. Rather, the fall of morals and human values is criticized in his poem in Hope's characteristic beating satire. Judith Wright, championing the Australian land and the Aboriginal rights. Hailing from the family of the pioneering pastoralist who settled in New England, Judith Wright was conscious of her ancestral liberal humanist tradition. Her gradual realization of the deprivation of the Aboriginals and the destruction of the ancient Australian landscape in the hand of the colonial settlers, and her ancestors' participation in the process of annihilation, moved her to a kind of expiation through her poetry. Besides the direct and emotional textures of her poetry, Wright's writing campaigned for Aboriginal rights as well as propagated the conservation of Australian land and people. As Parthapratim Dasgupta points out, Judith Wright celebrates Australia, covered with the misty aura of oral narratives, native myths and stories that have the capacity of constantly haunting an ardent lover of this rugged, jagged country. While life is harsh, out the well-earned fruits of labor essentially sweet, Judith Wright's famous poem, Woman to Man, poetically renders the creation of life through the sexual intimacy, which is presented by beautiful symbolic expressions of the moments of physical togetherness of the woman and the man. The eyeless laborer in the night, the selfless, shapeless seed I hold, builds for its resurrection day, silent and swift and deep from sight, forces the unimagined light. Her poems try to converge the two worlds, the world of the indigenous and the world of the non-indigenous settlers. As a conservationist and as the champion of Aboriginal rights, she not only campaigned for the preservation of the Aboriginal culture and people, but she succeeded in translating the Aboriginal experience in many of her poems. According to John Williams, in her own way, she has taken a step further for us in the expression of Australian national, spiritual, and environmental values in her poetry. Now let us talk about Kenneth Slessor and R.D. Fitzgerald's poetry. Kenneth Slessor and R.D. Fitzgerald's poetry brings in modernism in Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. Slessor's volume of poetry, Earth Visitors, 1926, and Five Bells, 1929, focus more on image and symbols. 40 Years Poem, 1965, and Product Later Verses by Robert D. Fitzgerald in 1977 by Robert D. Fitzgerald are much more committed to philosophical poetry. Their later poems deeply engage with the varied concept of history and time. According to a critic, Kenneth Slessor was probably the most talented one to have written in Australia and the first renovator of 20th century Australian poetry. Slessor's career as a poet ran in tandem with his life as a hard-working journalist. He seems to have been able to turn off the raucous babble of everyday Sydney like a radio and to produce the piercing, rinsed clean order of words that characterize his best poetry. The poetry of Rosemary Dobson and Queen Harwood. David McHugh, in his introduction to Rosemary Dobson's poetry, points out that Rosemary's poetry is haunted by vexatious apparitions, omens, annunciations, prophecies, and premonitions. Her poetry is also light and lucid in tone, as well as find in her books of poems like Convex Mirror, 1944, and Ship of Ice, 1948. Renaissance paintings were one of the major shaping forces in her poetry. Her poetry ranges from the formal verse to free verse. Literary realism and the poetry of Charis Wallis Crabbe. The 1960s and the 1970s saw the emergence of intense literary realism in the poetry of the Australian writers of European descent. Francis Webb, 1925 to 1973, wrote poems on the themes of religious exploration and nature of poetic creativity, realistic engagement with the socio-political circumstances, and often satiric presentation occupy the poetry of Chris Wallace Crabbe, Bruce Daw, and Vincent Barclay. The poetry of Bruce Daw represents his satiric portrayal of the social and political issues, religious overtones, and traditional literary realism can also be traced in his poetry, published in his book No Fixed Address, 1962. This satiric realism is evident in Wallace Crabbe's Eliotesque portrayal of the private hell of the citizens of Melbourne in his famous poem Melbourne. The Wurri urbanism is evident in the concluding lines. Highway by highway, the remorseless cars strangle the city, put it out of pain, its limbs still kicking feebly on the hills. Nobody cares. The artists sail at dawn, for brisker ports, or rot in public birds. Though much has died here, little has been born. The city is represented in negative terms, where the citizens suffer disgruntlement, intellectual and emotional barrenness plague the city, which is becoming claustrophobic for the citizens of Melbourne. Verse novels of Dorothy Porter and Les Moore. One of the oldest poetic genres, the verse novel was revival in the hand of a distinctive poetic voice in the history of Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. Other than her books of poetry, The Bee Heart 2009 and Love Poems 2010, Dorothy Porter reached eminence through her five verse novels, which are Akhenaten 1992, based on the Egyptian pharaoh of that name and told as a series of dramatic monologue, The Monkey's Mask 1994, a verse satire on the local poetry, What a Piece of Work 1999, dealing with a psychiatrist perception, Wild Sarmis 2002, engaging with the double perspective of a woman astronomer and her dying academic husband, and El Dorado 2007, a thriller set in Melbourne. The Oxford Companion of Australian Literature discusses Les Moore's poetic style in the following way. The continuing themes of much of his poetry are those inherent in that traditional nationalistic identity, respect, even reverence for the pioneers, the importance of the land and its shaping influence on the Australian character, admiration for the special Australian character, down-to-earth, laconic, we are a colloquial nation, and based on such bush-bred qualities as egalitarianism, practicality and straightforwardness and independence, special respect for that Australian character in action in wartime, the country soldiers, and a brook no argument preference for the rural life over the sterile and corrupting urban environment. Beside the famous volumes of poetry like The Vernacular Republic of 1976 and Dog Foxfield in 1990, Les Moore also contributed in the flourishing of the genre of verse novels, The Boys Who Stole the Funeral, 1980, and Fred Neptune, a novel in verse in 1999, are the verse novels written by Moore. Now, let us summarize our whole discussion, what we have learned from this module. Australian poetry, by the writer of European descent, began its journey under the influence of the European poetic traditions. A sense of nostalgia and exile also haunted the poems of the early Australian writers of European descent. But their gradual consciousness and attachment to the Australian landscape and the bush life endowed their poetry with a distinctive Australian flavor. Henry Lawson and Banjo Peterson were the major poetic voices in the early Australian poetry by the writers of European descent. In their poetry published in the leading Australian literary magazine, Bulletin, they represented two perspectives of the bush life, one realistic and other a romantic celebration of bush people's lived experience. Henry Kendall, Christopher Brennan, Adam Lindsay Gordon and C.J. Dennis were major poets during this phase of Australian poetry. Modern Australian poetry contemplates more on the philosophical engagement with the nature of being Australian by retelling and reshaping the Australian stories, its myths and symbols. Two poetic movements like Zindi Orobaks and the Angry Penguins debated two aspects of Australian poetry. The Zindi Orobak intend to present the Australian culture in propagating a kind of literary nationalism, while the Angry Penguins promoted experimental iconic birds. Poets like Douglas Stewart, James Macaulay, David Campbell, Rosemary Dobson, Vivian Smith wrote meditative verse. The satiric and allusive poetry of Eddie Hope and the emotionally enriched verse of Judith Wright present a convergence of the two worlds of the indigenous and the non-indigenous literature and culture. The texture of modern Australian poetry by the writers of European descent is varied, experimental, and rich with philosophical and mythical meanings. For further reading, you can follow the reference list and the links provided here, and there is also a self-assessment file that also you can consult. Thank you.